Hi, I'm Meena Malik Hussain and you're watching The Coffee Table, and today we have an ultra special show because we are going to be talking about a wonderful thing, which is classical music in Pakistan. But joining me on set today are my two favorite teachers. So I'm in equal measures very excited and also a little nervous because I was a very good student and I'm delighted to have them, but you know, sort of keep appearances up in front of your favorites. So joining me today on set is Dr. Ghazala Irfan, who is the Secretary General of the All Pakistan Music Conference and also a philosophy professor. And we've got Sara Zaman, who is an eminent vocalist, a teacher, taught me, and also is the Vice President of the APMC as well. So hello, ladies.
Hello.
Nice to see you. Thank you for joining me today.
Thank you.
Wonderful to have both of you. I'm a bit nervous. I'm having a classroom feeling. So tell me, Dr. Irfan, your father, Hayat Khan Sahab, was the one who set up the All Pakistan Music Conference.
Right.
And there's this wonderful story about it. And I want you to tell me firsthand about it. Like back in 1959.
That's right.
Yes.
Well, Roshan Ara Begum, who had come to Lala Musa from India, she didn't have an audience, and there was no platform where she could perform. So one day she just announced that she was going to stop singing.
Ah.
And my father got together with another very good friend who was also interested in classical music, Rauf Ansari, and the two of them together said, we have to set up some platform where she can perform. So they set up the All Pakistan Music Conference. So they nominated each other. He said, I nominate you, the Secretary General of the All Pakistan Music Conference. And he said, I nominate you as the treasurer. And they put out, I think, 5,000 rupees then.
Yeah, that's a lot of money back then.
And they said, here we go. And since then, there's been no looking back. Because this year is going to be the 60th year of the music festival.
Huzzah! Huzzah! And you know, like, touch wood, it's been going strong since then. There has been and again, it says it's conference, but it's actually a sort of a 6-day long
festival
of music.
Right.
And that includes all kinds of performances.
Right. What it does also is it has students' competitions.
Yes.
So we begin with that. And we have all the genres of classical music plus folk music.
Okay.
So it isn't just purely classical. So we have Tumri, Dadra, Kafi, Ghazal, Geet as well. And students perform in each one of these genres. And most of our people who've, let us say, been competing, they've really turned out to be great stars now.
Wonderful.
Naira Noor being one of them.
Oh, she's an alumnus of the APMC.
That's right.
Oh, how wonderful. And there's also dance.
Well, we do perform, you know, but we have very few dancers.
This is
Nahid
true.
Naheed Siddiqui has performed, Shima Kirmani has performed. But unfortunately, there are very few occasions where we have dance. But initially, the first year that the music conference, we had two people coming from India. One was Gopi Krishan. And the story about Gopi Krishan is that when they had the dance performance at the open air theater, the whole
in Lawrence Gardens.
That's right.
Yes.
That's where the venue of the music conference has always been.
Yes.
And the theater was packed to capacity to the extent that people had no space, so they were sitting on trees.
Oh, how wonderful and dedicated.
And the next year, we had Miss India, Indrani Rahman.
Ooh.
So we had two of the top dancers, and that really set the tone.
Yes.
But also from India, we had the Dagar brothers.
Okay. And who were those? Because for our audience, you know, this is all an educational experience.
Well, the Dagar brothers are the Dhurpad singers of the subcontinent.
And what is Dhurpad?
Well, Dhurpad is the ancient genre, which actually some people say was really restricted to the temples.
Okay. And so devotional music.
It was more devotional. I mean, later on it sort of ventured out, but initially that was the whole purpose of it. And the Dagar brothers, and there are very few people now, even in India, who there are the Dagar brothers and the lineage, and they're the Gundecha brothers. But other than that, I think there are very few Dhurpad players even there, or Dhurpad singers even there.
Oh, so what do you mean by a Dhurpad player? Is it an instrument also?
Well, the veena.
Okay.
Is the Vichitra Veena, which is two goads. And you play the Dhrupad style on that.
Right.
Oh, so this is a genre. It's not that it's... so it's not an instrument.
But we'll come back to this, about how sort of some forms of music are waning, the practice of it is waning, and we'll sort of loop back to that anon. But Auntie Sarah, tell me, you've been associated with the APMC for a while now, but your journey, your musical journey began much later, back when you were 12.
Yes.
And you wanted to sing.
Much earlier.
Yeah, much earlier. Even younger than that. So you've always wanted to sing.
Yes, that's like when I started to talk, I think, I was singing. And we were very fortunate, both my sister and myself. My sister learned classical Kathak from Maharaj Ghulam Hussain Kathak at the Alhambra Arts Council, Lahore, when the director was Dr. Anwar Sajjad.
Right.
And the principal was Ustad Firoz Nizami.
Mm-hmm.
So our parents, I think they had the courage to take both their daughters, especially to the Alhambra once we settled in Lahore. And that's the time I think I was 12.
Yes.
And my sister, for my sister, the first class for Kathak was initiated. And
So she's the one who sort of began the
And we were in the old Alhambra building. It was a winter residence of a Nawab and had a beautiful pine forest as a garden, the present Alhambra. And Ustad Firoz Nizami was the principal. He was from Kirana Gharana, Ustad Behre Wahid Khan Sahab's shagird, and in Khayal Gaiki. And he initiated me to initiated me to classical music, because when my mother took us there, the question that he asked my mother was that, what kind of music do you want your daughter to learn? So my mother was a bit taken aback and surprised, and she said, well, we want that our child should learn the knowledge of music. And that really touched him and inspired him, because he says that after partition, mostly people just wanted to come to the Alhambra as a tuition place and just do some geet or ghazal at the most and not go beyond that.
So geet and ghazal were the more popular forms that they wanted to sort of practice.
Yes, because film music was quite
popular
at that point. And but the thing to remember is that the people who were part of the film music were very finely trained musicians and vocalists
and composers,
both, also in the orchestra you had the finest instrumentalists and trained by the leading ustads of the subcontinent.
And because it was so sort of fresh after partition that people were trained in the sort of, you know, by the best, like you said, because they still had access to them, the kind of access that we don't now have to a lot of ustads still now, who obviously have gharanas in India. So was your mother a little nervous, because, you know, girls learning music and there's a certain sort of social
stigma
attached to that?
But you know, in our family, we all were sort of naturally inclined towards music.
Because nobody can say no.
And more than just, I think when we were on our own, we would be singing together. And that was with my uncles and aunts as well. So, and we were interested in serious music through a maternal aunt of mine who learnt from Bade Ustad Fateh Ali Khan Saab. The sitar. And so that was our first exposure at home of Khala learning very seriously from such a great maestro. And unfortunately, all these gems, they didn't get the kind of patronage and recognition after partition, which happened all over the subcontinent, really. And then Khayal Gaiki, I think it was like Dr. Ghazala pointed out that Malika-e Mausiqi, Roshan Ara Begum Sahiba had given up music.
And that's tremendous for somebody of that stature and that talent to be so disheartened, to just say that I can't do this anymore.
Yeah.
You see, because from the Nawabs, who were the patrons of music, I mean, once those states were not there, there was, what were they supposed to do? Who were they supposed to...
Quite right. And patronage is a massive part of at least subcontinental music. And we're just going to take a quick break and come back and talk more about that. So we'll see you in a minute. Hi, welcome back to the Coffee Table. We're talking classical music with two pros on set. So we were, before the break, we were talking about patronage of music and how important it was for the sort of creative arts to have a patron. And in the subcontinent, those patrons used to be the Nawabs, who would then have their own courts and then have their own musicians and poets in those courts. So that's how it sort of sustained the life of those creative people.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then after partition...
Well, there were no further Nawabs, so...
Yes.
So what were the classical musicians to do? Which is why the music conference also came into the arena, more or less.
Yes. To sort of provide that kind of support, if not monetary, then at least the platform where people knew where to come. And from what I read, the conference has always done really well.
Well, it's so surprising that people say that classical music is dying out. But last year, in these competitions that I just mentioned, we had 50 students under the age of 10.
Wow.
And we have 50 students over the age of 10 from schools. This is, I'm only talking about schools for classical music.
That's excellent.
Yes.
That's 100 children.
That's
who are singing at a level where they are good enough to perform.
That's right.
At the conference.
Yes. Well, this is a competition, not performance. But out of which, you know, we select about 50 out of about 350.
Oh, wow.
Yes. So there's so many people who are interested in competing.
And who are singing at a school level, but somehow not really sort of pursuing it, perhaps, as a career, necessarily. And I think that's where then your work with the NCA probably comes into play, with the musicology department. And you've been there since the beginning. So how has that been? What's the response like there?
The response has grown over the years. And like we were talking earlier about the stigma attached to learning music, especially, I do not know where that comes from, because we do understand, because earlier we were talking about the patronage. And the patron was always a well-informed, knowledgeable patron, a person who would support the musicians and artists and could appreciate and recognize excellence.
Which is, that's also very important.
It is so important.
It used to be part of a civilized upbringing to understand music, to know the nuances, to have a good ear for it. And then and then you would know how to recognize something that was good as well.
Exactly. So knowledge of something, of any discipline, is so important to be able to set standards for it.
Right.
And to recognize excellence and to help promote excellence.
Yes.
And and to make all sorts of facility for people treading this path. So what happened was that because of lack of it, because I think the patronage was maybe lying with the bureaucrats who were not necessarily informed about music and the performing arts. And so to have well-informed, responsible people, it was imperative to have a place of learning for music, at least. And we set up...
Excuse the interruption. My father used to say, we don't only need gawaiya, we also need sulvaiya.
Sulvaiya.
And what is a sulvaiya?
Sulvaiya, people who
sulvaiya,
can appreciate.
Of course. Yes, yes. It's not just a performer, but you have to have a listener who knows what they're hearing.
Exactly, because this is a language.
Yes.
And secondly, that, you know,
it's also a language, but it's a language that gets an art sort of music, our traditional classical music, the language is passed down from teacher to student. And that's not the traditional formal way, but that's just our way. But it must have been really difficult to teach it formally in a classroom.
It is difficult to engage the students on and just an academic level.
Yes.
And we do have 50-50, if not 65 at one time and 35 practice and 65 theory. And ideally, it should be 50-50 weightage of theory and music, because it goes hand in hand.
Yes.
And because just becoming a theorist is not good enough, and just being a practitioner without the adequate information is not not exactly. So the point was that in 4 years it's a full bachelor's degree that we offer at National College of Arts. The 4 years are not enough to make a musician or to impart the kind of fine honing that it requires to be able to become a relatively good musician. So the idea was to facilitate people coming in, students coming in, to be well informed about the subject, so they could make responsible decisions after having finished the their the degree.
And I'm sure it's also a sort of, it adds a kind of legitimacy to the endeavor as well, to have a degree in it. You know, that you went to school for 4 years, you studied this, you have a degree, and you know, now you can. I'm sure it's reassuring for parents also.
It is reassuring. Remember, there's so many TV channels now, they're making films here, so they need music all the time.
Yes.
They need event management. You don't get good recording engineers, you know, sound engineers. But the what is necessary is that with these students, after having finished their degree, they can then become apprentices to the traditional ustads, you know, if they want to pursue vocals, if they want to become, they want to sort of progress in the academic field, then they should, they can find their direction if they want to write about it, they want to go into sound engineering, they want to go into event management or to TV channels. And unfortunately, there is so much that can be done, because just music conference cannot, is not enough
of course not.
For our
we need several conferences.
You need several such conferences.
In fact, what we also do is that the first of every month, except for the summer months, we have a concert where we have a designated time, because at the music conference itself, the festival, you can't allow just one musician to take over.
Yes.
So you have to curtail their performance, which is really unfair to them. But at least people get to listen to everybody. So then at the monthly concerts, then we give people the time.
That's wonderful.
Yes.
That's lovely.
And what is required really is that the channels, the private channels or the state channel, must dedicate a time for the traditional classical music. Unfortunately, we don't have any of that. We used to in Radio Pakistan, but unfortunately, because people look for feasibilities, we need support from the state or the private enterprise to be the patrons for these traditional.
And it's so surprising to me that if one talks about feasibility, and just the fact that, like you were mentioning earlier, that you have people from all strata of society who come to the conference and are enthusiastic and listen and sit there and are fabulous audiences.
That's right.
Yes. So those are the same people who would watch it on TV.
Yes, and you know, let me bring to your notice that some time back, Samar Television had this amazing competition for Sama, meaning children doing
Qawwali.
No, Hamd o Sana.
Okay.
Oh,
and,
all right.
Yeah. And I think I've watched that on YouTube, and I've often found myself crying, because the such small children They are singing Hamd and Sana in such difficult compositions set in rags. And I think but just by seeing that, I felt that you can never really take away something which is such an integral part of your being. And it has taken a new direction, maybe, that parents are sending their children to learn from different maestros performing Sama. Their children, they feel that, you know, and that is the beauty of it, because you can see these beautiful innocent spirits, you know, the souls expressing themselves. And it is very it's very encouraging, you know, like just you were saying that it's a false perception that the classical music is dying. Yes, there is no patronage. Yes, there are no formal dedicated time on the channels, dedicated time on the Radio Pakistan's in all the provinces. Yes. It's a shame. And because that's who we are, the folk music, our folk heritage, our traditional classical heritage, that is who we are. And it expresses the ethos of a society and ethos of a heritage that's been handed down to us. So, and we need I think we have these wonderful corporate
ventures, yes.
Ventures, like as in Coke Studio and Pepsi Battle of the Bands, which is wonderful because it gives, again, it's an opportunity for our talent to express themselves. But we need an alternate platform. We need an alternate platform which is just like somewhat like that for our folk and classical music, where our instruments are not tampered with, where the people are not, they don't have to comply to a given format. You know, even if in such, I have my appreciation for these studios and all that, but at the same time, it's something of concern that our instrumentalists are dying out, you know, like we do not have a Sarod Nivaz anymore.
Yes, of course.
I feel that with the coming of the patronage of the corporate sector, what we are catering to is what is popular music throughout the world. So American global music has become the paradigm for everybody to follow. It's not just Pakistan. And that means basically, like even Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan started that. He would sing his traditional qawwali. And then he would say, I will sing the same qawwali with Western instruments. Okay, so the idea was that, you know, he's bringing the qawwali to the contemporary period. However, the two types of music are different in structure. The classical music is melodic. You know, it's based on melody. It's a melody repeated over and over again with improvisation, and then the melody comes back together with the tabla, which the percussion that provides you the basic rhythm. Whereas Western music is orchestra based. It is harmony. It is played, let's say, notes are not played successively. They are played simultaneously. They're played all together. In our music, it's one note after the other. It's not that they're
modal,
all played
modal
together.
Structure. It's a modal structure.
So if we have these two totally different structures, and yes, it is the current situation is the hybrid situation in everything.
Yes.
But that really also means that unless we are able to retain our traditional, that will all go away.
So you're saying without the basics that we know, we can't possibly now sort of modernize or move towards Western music without knowing our own primary language
but
first.
But see, so also what they've done is they've used our basic folk tunes and started playing Western instruments with it. There's very little creativity. If it was creative, I'd say by all means.
Yes.
But it isn't.
This is an excellent sort of arc that we're taking, and we're just going to take a quick break for like 1 second. Come back very soon. Hello, welcome back to the coffee table. We're in the middle of an extremely interesting conversation about how we can be modern, but in order to be that, we have to remember our own musical mother tongue as it was.
Of course.
Yes, you were saying.
Yeah, I would like to add to that fusion is sort of very attractive.
Yes.
But one must remember that to be able to make such music, one has to have a very good knowledge of one's own tradition and to have to be knowledgeable of the other tradition.
Yes.
And then you find
a happy balance.
A happy balance.
If you want to even have a balance.
Yes, and you can have a dialogue.
Yes.
You can have a dialogue.
Between the genres.
Yes, between
and
the
approaches.
Two traditions. Yeah. And but just to sort of jump into it without really knowing about yourself and your saying yourself is one's own tradition and the knowledge and the practice that it requires, it is it can stagnate also.
Because then if you, again, you don't have the words, you don't have the vocabulary, then how are you going to sort of make something new? Otherwise, you'll just be repeating the same old patterns. And I feel like nowadays a lot of younger people, again, would listen to Western music, and a lot of people are famous now who just used to maybe pick up a guitar and sing on YouTube and are now super famous. And kiddos here seem to think that, of course, we can also do this, but that's not how we need to operate, evidently.
No, they only have very transitional value. It just works for one song and that's it. Because they don't have the skills and they don't have the knowledge. So it works because remember that we're all natural singers, like you said. You know, we don't speak, we sing.
Yes.
So that's the way it was. We do poetry. We're so good at the oral tradition.
Yes.
So in some ways then it was important that we continue that oral tradition. But at the same time, we still need to know the art, the nuances, like we talked about, the knowledge, the intrinsic value of these things.
And that, yes, I don't want to interrupt.
No, the thing is that you are absolutely right about that. And
so, would it be useful, for example, if I were to bring my children to the conference? Are children allowed?
Yes,
at
of course.
Conference.
Of course.
Yes, as long as they're not rowdy, they can sit in quietly.
That's
listen.
Right.
Because a great deal of it is listening as well.
But and see, the monthly concerts that I was talking about, we have a format. The first performer is always an amateur.
Right.
And we generally pick up one of the prize winners.
Okay.
And they have their own audience. So they have all these young people coming to listen to their own
friends. Yeah.
But then we have an instrument and then we have a vocalist. So every time it's the same format. I mean, they're different vocalists, they're different instrumentalists.
Yes.
But we do promote the amateurs because they also need a platform.
Quite right. And they're the ones who are going to then
take over
to the future as well. So now I feel like a lot of people who are interested in music are also interested in singing because it seems to be the primary performative role to have. But then there's also the instruments. And we were talking about this earlier, about how there are a lot of instruments that people don't play anymore, or instruments that are becoming obsolete.
Simply because, unfortunately, please go ahead.
I said the sarangi has been the greatest calamity. The sarangi is the closest to the human voice, and it was always used as an accompaniment to the vocalist. But it requires so much intricate work and so much practice that people are not doing it anymore. Like you said, anybody can pick up a guitar and start singing. Yeah. It's so natural and spontaneous. The sarangi is not natural and spontaneous. So it requires such dedicated work that people are giving up. Also the veenas, for example, that also requires a lot of work.
Yes.
And in some ways, you know, like the tradition now is to act smart, not work hard, but work smart. So the whole concept of speed is there.
Yes. Mm. And you can't possibly have music, or at least music. Classical, Eastern classical music, with speed. That's hardly, it's not something one associates with that kind of music at all. No. So it's an investment that should begin sort of early, and then you just keep.
Yeah, it's more of a spiritual expression. Mm. It, your training is, it's a holistic training.
Right.
It's a training wherein, like we were talking earlier, it's a one-on-one. It's a tradition where you are trained one-on-one by your mentor. And it's a lifelong commitment. Mm. You don't go ustad hopping, you know, yes, that I'm learning from this ustad and then I'm learning from the other. Because it's a very special bond. Mm. And the transference of knowledge takes place, I think through the commitment, integrity, the love for the art, both from the mentor and the shagird, the student. Mm. And it is important, I feel, that I think this is where we need to be conscious of our responsibilities, that we must, if certain students show the capability, they must be then supported through scholarships to attach themselves in apprenticeship to whether it's an instrumentalist or a vocal ustad. Because even our orchestral music is dying out.
Right.
You know, they are just that old cadre who are still performing in orchestras.
So
but there's hardly any replacement.
What do you mean when you say orchestra, though? Do you mean sort of all sorts of instruments or just Western ones?
Like in film music,
yes.
You have an arrangement. Mm. Mm. You have an arrangement, and in that many, in the past, many great ustads used to perform and be part of that arrangement.
Okay.
Ustad Sharif Khan Saab Poonchwala used to perform. Ustad Nabi Bakhsh, Ustad Nazim Ali Khan Saab on the Sarangi, Nabi Bakhsh Khan Saab.
Right. And I really like how there was that crossover.
Yeah.
With so, for sort of television, but also with their own private
even for their survival, because there were hardly any opportunities for them to perform and just dedicate themselves to the genre they were performing. But I think we need, the reason why children today end up just taking up the guitar and the drums and the keyboard and all is because it is very easily accessible on the net. You can learn the chords and the basics immediately. So we need something like that for our music, where it is more accessible. Mm. And secondly, to encourage students through scholarships, both for the ustads and for the students.
Ah, yes, I think that's an important sort of distinction.
Exactly.
Here also.
And so that there is some responsibility in sort of preparing the shagird or the student.
And I think it's also important to consider that you are a professor of philosophy, which is a very sort of intellectual subject. And do you find that parents generally want that the interest in humanities is decreasing as it
is?
Yes,
because the values are now all becoming what are called commercial values.
Yes, yes.
Society has been monetized and everything is in terms of money. Mm. As a result, the non-instrumental values, you know, which are the arts, for example, they're not, unless they're translatable into whether you can earn from them, they're not really looked up to.
Mm. They're not seen as useful.
That's right.
But neither
is philosophy, neither is literature. I mean,
they're invaluable to us as humans.
And without them, you can't really function.
No.
But just by confining yourself to them, you can't earn a living.
Yes. Mm. So one could take a musical education and an interest, and having an ustad can be done side by side with the more kind of practical academic pursuit as well. So you could be studying computers or accounting, but you could also have your ustad coming in and teaching you music.
Throughout
you can
the
do
world,
it simultaneously.
In schools, you have to take one musical instrument or singing. It's part of the mandatory curriculum.
Yeah.
And I think we need to do that. In fact, we had a tradition like that, which we've just given up.
Actually, if the whole idea of setting this Department of Musicology was that maybe it'll have a trickle-down effect, that these performing arts of music and dance will be made part of the mainstream curriculum. You know, because remember when I was teaching you?
Yes. You know, I remember so much from that. And I was very little. I was sort of 8 or 9. And I still remember the rags. Even now, wow. I'm probably not very good at singing them anymore. But I remembered them. And we did a lot of difficult, quote-unquote, concepts. And the idea of rags at different times of the day. And in different tempos. And you know.
Yeah. And always with live orchestra,
yes.
with live supportive music. Never recorded when you were singing in batches of 40s and 50s, 150 of them.
Wow.
And I put my condition to the school that I'll only teach if you allow me to design my curriculum. And I wanted the children to learn how I had learned the Asthai Yantras, the rags, and kafi in our Punjabi Siraiki, and the poetry of our Sufi saints, and of great poets like the Allama Iqbal, Faiz Ahmed Faiz Sahab, and all of these children. They were so young, but we would discuss the concepts. And there was so much, they had so much capacity to absorb and so much beauty to express as little children that I don't think we should compartmentalize that this is what is meant for children and this is not meant for children. As long as you are able to share it and teach it.
Yes. And music is sort of
but
us,
also,
you know?
Unfortunately, also understand it. Because I remember we were saying lappe aati hai dua. We didn't say lappe aati hai dua. We didn't know what lappe aati hai dua.
I would
lappe aati hai dua.
I mean, and even the mangling the national anthem.
Yes. That was en masse, you know, sort of without understanding. But the whole idea was, like, if Mina recalls that we would sit and first we would discuss the poetry.
Yeah.
And the meanings of the words, even if they were in Punjabi. We even did Hazrat Shah Hussain's poetry, Bulle's poetry, Sultan Bahu's poetry. Yeah. So, and the different rags, Alayya Bilawal and all that.
I remember it. I was really proud of myself.
The devotional texts.
And she told me, I was like, I remember it. There's so much here to be done and there's so much value and it just keeps on giving. And this year it's going to be the 60th year of the All Pakistan Music Conference.
That's
which is
right.
Tremendous.
And it's been meeting regularly. So we have the annual festival and we have at least 6 to 8 concerts in the year.
And I love that the concert used to almost always be in the amphitheater in the Lawrence Gardens, which is sort of like quintessential, really sort of heart of Lahore sort of experience.
But also the other important thing is that our music is open to nature. You know, when you say the rags, this time of the day, I mean, you don't know indoors what time of the day it is.
Quite right.
So it has to be like, ye subha ka raag hai, ye dopahar ka raag hai, but you have to know this is subha or this is dopahar.
And to sing it at the right time probably has its own kind of magic to it.
Right.
And to be out there. And you know, I think now we're not going to be bit by dengue mosquitoes anymore. So it should be all right.
We should go back to nature. And in any case, we realize the value of going back to nature.
Yes. Absolutely. And music is a sort of path to do that. And I think we're so fortunate to be part of a cultural, historical tradition where it's really our inheritance. We don't even have to go far to find it.
That's right.
Ah, well, I've got this wonderful brochure. Showing you this brochure. The next one you see will have a 60 on it. Woohoo! Well done. And meet me there. I'm going to be there. And you should all be there as well to support music in Pakistan and classical music and all the beautiful gifts it has to offer us. Thank you so much, both of you, for being on the show with me today. It was a real honor and a real pleasure having my two favorite teachers with me. I've had a wonderful time, and I'm sure you guys have had a wonderful time. Thank you, as always, for watching. If you're watching this on YouTube, don't forget to like and subscribe, and we will see you next time on The Coffee Table. Bye now.